everybody, welcome back to my channel. Today I am doing Dares Out of the Love Dare Challenge by Stephen and Alex Kendrick. I am on day 25 today, so if you have missed any of my other videos, I will have them linked. Well, I'll have them at the end of this video. But today I'm on day 25 and it is Love Forgives. What I have forgiven, if I have forgiven anything, I did it for your sakes in the presence of Christ. That's 2 Corinthians 2:10. This one is tough, perhaps the toughest dare in the book. But if there is to be any hope for your marriage, this is the challenge that must absolutely be taken seriously. Counselors and ministers who deal with broken couples will tell you that this is the most complex problem of all. A rupture that is often the last to be repaired. It cannot just be considered, contemplated, but must be deliberately resolved. Forgiveness has to happen, or a successful marriage won't. Jesus painted a vivid image of forgiveness in his parable of the ungrateful servant. He described a man who owed an overwhelming sum of money about being surprised when his master totally canceled his debt. But upon release, the servant went out and found a poor man who owed him a very small amount and threw him in prison for not paying. When the master heard of his lack of forgiveness, he confronted the servant and put the original debt back on him. His lord, moved with anger, handed him out over the torturers until he should repay all that was owed. And that's Matthew 18:34.
Okay.
Torturers, prison.
Prison.
When you think of forgiveness, this is what should come to mind. For Jesus said, "My heavenly Father will also do the same to you if each of you does not forgive his brother from your heart." And that's Matthew 18:35. Imagine finding yourself in a prison-like setting. As you look around, you see a number of cells visible from where you're standing. If you see people from your past incarcerated there, people who wounded you as a child, you see people you once called friends, but who wronged you at some point in your life.
7, 6, 5.
You might see one or both of your parents there, perhaps a sibling or some other family member. Even your spouse is locked in nearby, trapped with all the others in jail of your own making. This prison, you see, is a room in your own heart. This dark, drafty, depressing chamber exists inside your every day. But Jesus is standing nearby, extending to you a key that will release every inmate. He's telling you to forgive them all. No, you don't want any part of it. These people have hurt you too badly. They knew what they were doing, and yet they did it anyway. Even your spouse, the one you should have been able to count on most of all. So you resist and turn away. You're unwilling to stay here any longer. Seeing Jesus, seeing the key in his hand, knowing he's asking you to do, it's just too much. But trying to escape, you make a startling discovery. You're shaking the camera, James. There is no way out. You've trapped inside, and with all other captives, your unforgiveness, anger, and bitterness must have made a prisoner of you as well. Like the servants in Jesus' story who was forgiven an impossible debt, you have chosen not to give and have been handed over to the jailers and torturers. Your own freedom is now dependent on your forgiveness. Coming to this conclusion usually takes a while. You see all kinds of risks involved in forgiving others, since you feel what they did was wrong, whether they admit it or not. They may not even be sorry about it. They may feel perfectly justified in their actions, even going so far as to blame you for them. But forgiveness doesn't absolve anyone of blame or clear their record with God. It just clears you of having to worry about how to punish them. When you forgive another person, you're not declaring them innocent. You're just turning them over to God, who can be counted on to deal with them His way. You're saving yourself the trouble of scripting any more arguments or trying to prevail in this situation. It's not about winning and losing anymore. It's about freedom. It's about letting go, extending the mercy you have been given. That's why you often hear people who have generally forgiven another person say, "I feel like a weight being lifted off my shoulders." Yes, that's exactly what it is. It's like a breath of fresh air rushing into your heart. The still darkness of the prison house is flooded with light and coolness. For the first time in a long time, you feel at peace. You feel free. But how do you do it? You release your anger and the responsibility for judging and punishing the person to the Lord. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will pay," said the Lord. That's Romans 12:19. You might still feel the need to confront them about what they have done, Matthew 18:15. But regardless, forgiveness should be ahead and happen now. How do you know you've done it? You know it, the thought of their name or the sight of their face, rather than causing your blood to boil, causes you to feel sorry for them instead, to genuinely hope that they get this turn around. Knowing that God is the judge of all, Jesus said, "If we have knowing against anyone, we should forgive," Mark 11:25. And then never stop forgiving, Matthew 18:12. Bitterness will poison and drain the vitality of any relationship. So when it's all said and done, the romance, intimacy, and enjoyment of your marriage is greatly dependent upon your mutual commitment to allow no unforgiveness to exist between the two of you. Great marriages are not produced by people who never hurt each other, only people who daily choose to keep no record of wrongs. 1 Corinthians 13:5. And today's dare is, whatever you haven't forgiven in your mate, forgive it today. Let it go. Just as we ask Jesus to forgive us of our debts, each day we must ask Him to help us forgive our debtors. Each day as well. Unforgiveness has been keeping you and your spouse in prison too long. Say from your heart, "I choose to forgive." What did you forgive your spouse today? How long have you been carrying the weight of it? What are the possibilities now that you release this matter to God? And I wrote, "David has never done anything too bad to me that I have a hard time forgiving him for it. I have been hurt more by others, and I have forgiven most of them, so why wouldn't I forgive David? Sometimes David and I do argue, but I've always have forgiven him. It might take me a day, but I always do. David's a lot quicker to forgive than I am. Within maybe an hour, he usually forgives. For the other people, most of them I held on for a little bit, but I gave them over to God. The ones, when I think about them, who still stings, I've had for multiple years. I do need to try to forgive and hand them over to God." And a little extra it says is, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And that is Luke 23:34. And a girl named Andrea said, "We have forgiven each other and are starting over." All right, that is today's there. All right, today we are on day 26. And it is, love is responsible. When you judge another, you condemn yourself, since you, the judge, do the same things. That's Romans 2:1. God had designed His gift of marriage with many priceless benefits. Research shows that married people are happier, healthier, live longer, make more money, and have better sex lives. They also produce healthier, happier children than people who remain single. Do you realize how much value your spouse adds to your life? It's almost incomprehensible. But as with anything in life, the benefits we enjoy in marriage depend on how responsible we are in taking good care of it. That's why taking personal responsibility is one of love's greatest requests. Unpopular? Yes. but it is the key to whether marriage is a glorious union or a devastating failure. Each marriage is living garden placed under the care of a husband and wife, both of you. The more responsible you are to fulfill your vows, roles, and duties, the more you'll enjoy the many delights and wonders of your oneness. But the less responsible you become, the more painful and divisive the consequences. It is foolish, for example, for a man to desire healthy children and great intimacy in the bedroom, but not lift a finger to help his wife around the house or with training the kids. It is foolish for a woman to hope for financial stability and a happy marriage, but then spend without boundaries and refuse to meet her husband's sexual needs. Love and wisdom compel us not to neglect our responsibilities. How about you? How are you doing with honoring what you promised at the altar? Is your marriage blooming under your care or wilting instead? Are you making your spouse carry all the weight, or are you looking for ways to lighten their load? Love calls us to take full responsibility for our partner in marriage, to love them, to cherish them, to help them. But that's not all. Love also compels us to take responsibility for something else in our marriage, our own mistakes. We are so quick to justify them, so quick to deflect criticism, to find fault with our spouse instead, who's always the closest target and the easiest to blame. We tend to believe we are always more correct than they are, and we don't think anybody, given our circumstances, would have acted much differently. But love doesn't pass the blame or justify wrongs. It doesn't make excuses. Instead, it faces reality about areas of personal weakness and failure that need to be willingly addressed. So next time you're in an argument with your spouse, stop and see if there's some truth to what he or she is saying. What might happen instead of denying, blaming, and working up on your comebacks, you humbly receive the rebuke and take responsibility for your wrongs? The scripture says, "Reprove a wise man, and he will love you." That's Proverbs 9:8. Love is wise and agreeable, willing to admit and correct its faults up front, to confess, to repent, to change, to hunger and thirst for a right relationship with each other. Again, this is love. A real heart of repentance may take a while to grow in you. Pride is very resistant to responsibility, but humility and honesty before God and your spouse are crucial for a healthy relationship. This doesn't mean you're always in the wrong or you should become a doormat, but if something is not right between you and your spouse or between you and God, making it right should be your first priority. Are you taking responsibility for your own failures? Have you said or done things to your spouse that are wrong? What about to God? If we say that we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves and the truth is not in us, the Bible says in 1 John 1:8. However, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive our sins and cleanse us from our righteousness. That's 1 John 1:9. Denial means living a lie, but we receive mercy from God at the point of our confession. The same is true in marriage. Apologies bring amazing breakthroughs. They can tear down walls of resistance, rebuild relational bridges, unclog pipelines of communication, and reignite feelings of affection. Even if your spouse is 90% wrong, the sooner you offer a genuine apology for your 10%, the quicker the healing can begin and things can get back on track. You're coming back, okay. Can your spouse say that you have wronged or wounded them in a way that you've never made it right? Yours can. I didn't know you were married. I don't believe so, but this is what I said. I said, I don't believe so, but I will ask to make sure. If so, then it's time to humble yourself. Be honest about your offenses and repair the damage. Think of it an act of love. God wants no unresolved issues left standing between the two of you. God, ever ask ever. God doesn't want any issues between left standing between the two of you, ever. Ask Him to show you where you have fallen short in your responsibility and get things right with Him first. Then once you've done that, get right with your spouse as well. But to do this sincerely, you must swallow your pride and seek forgiveness regardless of how your spouse responds. Your responsibility to courageously work through your own issues should not be affected by whether they choose to react kindly or coldly to you. This may be one of the most difficult things you've ever done, but is crucial to taking the next step to your marriage and with God.
You need to miss so we can get back to Miss Bob.
If your heart is sincere, you may be surprised at the grace and strength He gives you when you take this step. Taking responsibility is always a loving thing to do. Okay, today's dare. Take time to pray through your areas of responsibility and your areas of wrongdoing. Where have you failed?
I have failed.
Ask for God's forgiveness.
I did fail.
Then humble yourself enough to admit them to your spouse.
I feel better.
That's good. Do it sincerely and truthfully. Ask your spouse forgiveness as well. No matter how they respond, make sure you cover your responsibility in love. He goes on to say, How did your mate react to your apology? What does he or she need in order to believe that your confession was more than just words?
No.
And I wrote, I actually did this the other day before reading this chapter. I apologized for not doing something that David had been wanting me to do. He thought it was good because of him.
David.
Yes, Daddy. David is your daddy. But I had to reassure him it wasn't him
Daddy's
at all.
David.
That it was all me and what I was going through. When I told him it wasn't because of me and not him, I believe that made him feel better. I was here first, James. With that confession, there was an apology. He seemed to accept it. I will bring it up with another apology and I'll see what he says and how he reacts. And I don't even actually remember what that was.
I don't know.
I guess we were both over it. No, I'm not done yet. Okay. Then it says, a little extra, it says, as each one must examine his own work in regard to himself alone. That's Galatians 6:4. And it also said that someone who's done this love dare before has said, If you would have asked me a year ago if I wanted to be with her, I would have told you I'm leaving the past behind me. But God has showed me what pure love is. And that's from someone named Chris. All right, now I'm on day 27. It is Love Encourages. And it says, guard my soul and deliver me. Do not let me be ashamed, for I take refuge in you. And that's Psalms 25:20. Marriage has a way of altering our vision. We go in expecting our mate to fulfill our hopes and make us happy. But this is impossible. This is an impossible order to fill. The higher expectations, the more likely your spouse will fail you and cause you frustration. If a wife always expects her husband to be on time, read her mind, and understand all her needs, if he always expects her to look radiant, blindly support his decision, and stay emotionally ready for sex, both of them will set each other up for daily failure. They will likely live most of their married lives in constant disappointment. But if they are realistic enough to understand that their spouse is human, occasionally forgetful, and sometimes weak and thoughtless, they'll be more delighted when their mate is responsible, loving, and kind. Divorce is inevitable when people refuse to allow their spouses to be human. So make a transition in your thinking. Choose to live by encouragement rather than expectations. The way your spouse has been for the last 10 years is probably what he or she will be like in the future, apart from your loving encouragement and an intervention from God. That's why love puts the focus on personal responsibility and improving ourselves rather than demanding more from others. And I like that, so, and underline it, so I'm going to read it again. That's why love puts the focus on personal responsibility and improving ourselves rather than demanding more from others. Jesus painted a picture of this when he said, "Can you say to your brother, 'Let me take that speck out of your eye, and behold, the log is in your own eye?' You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." And that's Matthew 7:4-5. Does your spouse feel like they're living with a speck inspector? Are you routinely on edge, fearful of not living up to your expectations? Would they say they spend most of their days sensing more of your disapproval than your acceptance? Perhaps you would respond by saying that the problem is not with you, but with them. If you really do come up short in a lot of areas, why is it your fault? As far as you're concerned, it takes both of you doing everything you can for your marriage to work. Your mate may think that you're overly critical, but you feel the issues you bring up are legitimate. You're not saying you're perfect, but it seems like you should be able to point out genuine problem areas, right? The problem with this mentality is that few people are able to respond to criticism with joyful inspiration. And I said, I know when David criticizes me, it never goes well, even when it does come from the heart. When it seems clear to your spouse that you're unhappy with them, whether by direct confrontation or with silent treatment, it's hard for them to feel deflated instead of motivated. And I said, that's exactly how I feel, is deflated when David criticizes me, or just, you know, I really don't think he means harm, but still makes me feel bad. After all, unlike any other friendship, your relationship began with both of you willing, bending over backwards to please the other. You never expected to reach the point where you think nearly everything they do is wrong, and you're struggling at times with even liking this person. When hopes are daily dosed with cold reality, your natural reaction is to communicate ongoing frustration with them. But sadly, rather than just making them want to correct things, your disapproval only makes them want to walk away or dig in deeper. Love is too smart for that. Instead of putting your mate in a position to rebel, love says to give them the grace and room to be themselves. Even if you're the goal-oriented type who places high demands on yourself, love calls you to lead by example, but not to force those same standards on your mate's performance. Marriage is a relationship to be enjoyed and savored along the way. It's a unique friendship designed by God Himself, where two people live together in a flawed imperfection, yet deal with it by encouraging and building, not by exhausting and belittling. The Bible says, "Encourage the exhausted and strengthen the feeble." That's Isaiah 35:3. Encourage one another and build up one another. Encourage the faint-hearted. Help the weak. Be patient with everyone. 1 Thessalonians 5:11-14. Don't you want married life to be the place where you can enjoy free expression of who you are, growing within a safe environment that encourages you even when you fail? Your spouse does too. And I said, David says this occasionally. And your love gives them the privilege. And your love gives them that privilege. If your wife or husband has told you on more than one occasion that you make them feel beaten down and defeated, then you need to take those words to heart. You can either be a critical anchor holding them back, or a complimentary wing helping them soar. Being with you should recharge them and lower their stress level, not drain them and wear them out. God is not done with your spouse yet, so let Him work. Stop expecting your mate to understand all your thinking, desire all your wanting, and accomplish all your hoping. As much as they may wish they could, they can't. Instead, let them be inspired by your appreciation. Let them be empowered by the sincere prayers and strategic praise. Focus on their strengths and point out that they are getting right, what they're getting right. Let your words lift them to a new height. Then the person they're created by God to be may emerge with a new confidence and with a love that inspires you for years to come. Today's dare is: eliminate the poison of an unrealistic expectations in your home. Think of one or two areas where your spouse has told you that you're expecting too much and tell them you're sorry for being so hard on them about it. Praise them for something positive and assure them of your unconditional love. Then it says, when you place high expectations on your spouse that they don't feel internally motivated to attain, what does that tell you about yourself? What are some of the better ways to deal with these disconnects? What things have your spouse recently done well that you can point out and thank them for? And I said, I don't believe I put too high expectations on David. The only thing I really hound him on, I've mentioned many times before, is picking up after himself. I just noticed that he has been picking up more paper towels lately, and I need to thank him for that. I am going to keep my eyes open to see if I do put high expectations in another area, and I can ask David too to see what he thinks. All right, and a Bible verse that goes along with this is, let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. That's Hebrews 10:24. And then a guy named Mike, who's done the Love Dare, said, use this book, read it, and keep reading it. It feels so good to give love again. All right, that is the end of this video. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and go check out the other videos on my Love Dare challenge. I will have a playlist at the end of this video. And please subscribe and hit that bell so you don't miss any of our videos. All right, until next time. Thanks. Bye.